speak about our latest work with my collaborator Patrick Rappentrost on quantum machine learning for quantum anomaly detection. So what do I mean by quantum anomaly detection? So anomaly detection are algorithms whereby we look for unusual patterns in otherwise your expected or normal data. So it has a wide range of applications ranging from fraud detection. So if you're looking for unusual, you know, say, spending patterns on credit cards, which can give an indication that maybe there's a fraud or some intruder on in your system. Or it can be used in fault detection in critical systems like aircraft engines or nuclear power plants, and in intrusion detection in the context of cybersecurity. So I became interested in these problems when, in my work on delegated quantum computation. So you can imagine in the future, sometime, you know, everyone has their own, you know, small quantum processor, and you know, we're all connected by some kind of quantum internet. So we can communicate to each other not only using classical data, but also quantum data. And in this kind of setting, we expect security type of questions on intrusion detection or fraud detection to come up also in the quantum setting. So we just want to ask a basic question that, you know, can quantum machine learning help with anomaly detection in using quantum data or for quantum data? So it turns out there are a lot of classical machine learning algorithms for classical anomaly detection. And the natural question is if using quantum machine learning that can help with quantum anomaly detection. So we just want to take a first step in that direction. But before we go on, you know, where do we start? So we have to look in the classical literature, and actually anomaly detection is an enormous field in the classical literature in its own right. And you know, there are a whole lot of algorithms that, you know, people use, and the reason why there are so many algorithms is that there are so many different kinds of anomalies and situations under which we want to detect anomalies. And they broadly class into the following. So you have classification-based algorithms, things like support vector machines, spectral theory-based, so things like principal component analysis, nearest neighbor, so KN-based algorithms, or you know, k-means clustering-based algorithms, and statistical techniques. So if you have a good model of your underlying distribution that describes normal data, but sometimes you don't have these situations, so you have to have recourse to machine learning, and also information theoretic techniques. So using, you know, certain complexity measures to characterize your data, and then any deviations from that to might call an anomaly. So what we'll be doing is choosing just two very simple algorithms from this class, and then looking for a quantum analog to these and seeing if that's appropriate if we want to apply to quantum data. Okay, so first of all, I mentioned, you know, there are a lot of different kinds of anomalies. And they're broadly classed into three kinds. So you have point anomalies, contextual anomalies, and collective anomalies. And then you also have three contexts in which you want to study these anomalies. So you have supervised, unsupervised, and what Mark mentioned on Monday, you know, semi-supervised learning. So what do I mean by point anomaly So you might be given some, you know, collection of data, which you call normal, and then you're given another piece of data, right? So, but it's a single point. So in the context of, say, medical diagnoses, you know, your normal data can be many copies of, you know, healthy lung tissue photographs, and then you're given another photograph and you ask, you know, is this normal or not? You know, does this lung have emphysema? Right. So these are point anomalies, and then you also have contextual anomalies. So these are considered anomalies only within a given context. So say here in Verona, you know, the peak of your temperature here is in June, but in November, imagine that you also have, you know, a high temperature, right? So this is unusual for the context of November, right? So now we call that an anomaly. And you know, these type of anomalies usually come up in time series anomalies. And this is much, you know, very much related to the change point problems, which John, Gael, and Ramon were talking about in the quantum context, so the quantum change point problem. And then another type, you have collective anomalies. So this is where you have a collection of data which together form an anomaly. So you might have a very symmetrical system, and you know, all of a sudden, you know, some kind of symmetry breaking. So if you, like in the context of, again, you know, medical diagnoses, if you're looking at the EEG diagram of the human heart, and you have natural heartbeat pattern is the collection of the amplitude of how fast you're beating, which is given the anomaly. But we want to narrow it down. I mean, there are so many different kinds, and then there's so many different algorithms, so different kinds of algorithms. So we just want to narrow it down and look at the simplest kind of case. So we want to look at different contexts of anomalies. So we have supervised anomaly detection. So this is where we have labeled data on what is normal. We have labeled data on what is abnormal. So what are anomalies? And then we can use your usual two-class machine learning algorithms to say, okay, well, what is the difference between normal and abnormal, right? If we get a new data point. And these type of techniques we're very familiar with, but it's not very suitable in the context of security. So if you have malicious attackers in your system, or if you have a server you don't trust very much, you don't have a lot of data on when they're doing something unusual. You have a lot of different kind of intruders, and they have different kinds of models as to what they're doing. That's different. And then we have unsupervised anomaly detection. So we're just given a bunch of unlabeled data, and now we want to cluster them. And now we get to semi-supervised. So semi-supervised is the more common type of anomaly detection where you're given a lot of information on the normal data. Right? So in terms of aircraft engines, most of the time it's working well. So you have a lot of data on the parameters in which it's working well. But you hopefully don't have a lot of data on when things fail. Right? And you want to ask, if you're given this new data point, this new aircraft engine, right? You want to ask, does it belong to the class of that is normal or not? This is a semi-supervised setting. So we would like to concentrate on point anomalies in the semi-supervised setting. So this is sort of the most natural starting point because these are the simplest. And two of the popular algorithms for these are based on principal component analysis, PCA, and something called the one-class support vector machine. So these are very similar to two-class, but instead of separating your data into two classes. Now you just want to ask, does it belong to one class or does it not? Maybe motivate the PCA technique, let's have a think about what is the most naive type of anomaly detector you can have. Right? So you have M, piece of training data, which you call normal. And then you want to ask if you have a test output, this green dot there, does it belong to this class or not? And a very natural question to ask is, what is the kind of distance between this new data point and some characterization of your normal data? So what you can do is that you can define some centroids, some average of your normal data. And you can even center your data and then ask, well, what is a distance measure between your test state and your normal, the centroid of your normal data? And in the quantum context, this will correspond to you to finding the quantum fidelity between your test quantum state and the centroid quantum state. But we see that this is not sufficient. So let's just imagine we have two cases whereby you have the same distance between your test state to the centroid of your data. But on the one hand, the distribution of the normal data corresponding to case A, it looks like this. And in this kind of case, the green point kind of looks quite far from this cluster. So we say, okay, this kind of looks like an anomaly. But in case B, we have the same centroid point, but now the distribution of the normal data pattern is completely different. And in this kind of case, well, we're not so sure. Now the green point kind of looks normal. Right? So this means we need to go beyond sort of the most naive form of anomaly detection and take into account the distribution. And the favorite way to take into account the distribution of your normal data is through the covariance matrix, which we've heard a lot about already. And a proximity measure, so it's kind of a distance measure between your test data and your normal data, would be your normal naive distance, and you minus that by the variance of your normal data in the direction between your test state and your centroid state. Right, so this is the motivation for this definition. For the one class, I won't talk too much about the one class because it's very similar to the two class SVM. But the basic ideas are following. It's an atomization problem. So what you want to do is to find, you have your training data, which you label as normal. And then you have some hyperplane that characterizes your normal data pattern in such a way that you're maximizing the distance between your training data and the origin of your feature space, but at the same time minimizing the least squared distance between the training data and the hyperplane. And then you're given a test state, and you want to ask, well, what is the distance between this test state and your training states? And this would be sort of the distance between that and the hyperplane, which you've mentioned. And then this works, you know, similarly to two-class SVM, where now this distance measure is written in terms of your Lagrange multipliers from the atomization problem at the beginning. And then you have your data product, which you can turn into our kernel. And then to find your Lagrange multipliers, you solve a similar matrix regression problem. Okay. Right, so now all of this so far is purely classical. But we want to solve the quantum problem, right? And the quantum problem is the following. We have m training states are each of dimension d. So we have some state. It doesn't have to be pure, but we can start off with a pure. And then we're given a test a test quantum state, also dimension d. We want to ask, does this quantum test state belong to the class of your training quantum states? So what we could do, well, you say, well, why don't we just use the classical machine learning algorithm we just described? Right, so we do some state tomography on our quantum states, and then apply the classical machine learning algorithm for anomaly detection, which is perfectly feasible. But the issue is that, you know, tomography costs a lot. Right? So famously, I mean, if your dimensionality of your state is d, it's going to go as d squared. And then you have to do it n times or n plus 1 times because you have, you know, m training states. And the hoop is that for quantum machine learning, you know, are we able to have an improvement upon this? So we perform the same task, but we want an improvement upon doing full state tomography. And the kind of summary of our results are that if using the PCA method and the one-class SVM for pure quantum states, then we do have an exponential improvement in both the number of training states and the dimensionality. But for mixed quantum states, while we don't have the advantage for an improvement in the number of training states, we still get the exponential advantage in the dimensionality. And I'll very briefly go over what the algorithms are. So again, the pure state problem, we're given, you know, psi I, these are quantum training states which are labeled as normal. And then we want to ask if the test state belongs to this class. We have an analogous centroid state, and also the central state. And then we have a proximity measure. So the proximity measure that we defined earlier, which is, you know, the distance between your test, kind of the fidelity between your test quantum state and centroid state minus kind of the variance about your centroid state. And it turns out that it can be written in terms of your covariance matrix, which in the quantum form looks like this. But, you know, for the covariance matrix, as I said this morning, it can be turned into a density matrix, right? So then essentially, finding proximity measure comes down to finding the fidelity between this density matrix describing your covariance matrix and the centered quantum test state. And we have, you know, our usual technique for finding this fidelity. 3 minutes. Okay. So mine says 6 minutes. Then I'll run through this quickly. Okay, so. So using the swap test, right, then the total number of measurements we need to make in the swap test goes as polylog MD. So it's exponential advantage of both the number of training states and the dimensionality. And in the mixed case, we have these class operators, which create for us our training and test states. And then we have an analogous proximity measure. Proximity measure where it's motivated by looking at an analogous inner product between your pure quantum states, and we change that into the inner product between mixed quantum states. And then we also have a circuit for generating this inner product, where we have some quantum channel, so that's defined by the Kraussdorff radius p, and it's defined in this way. And again, we make measurements in the ancillary qubit. In the end, we ask for the probability of measuring a 1 versus measuring a 0. And we find out that can tell us what the inner product that we want is, and thereby recover proximity measures corresponding to mixed states. And in this kind of case, we get an exponential advantage in the dimensionality, but this purely scales polynomially with the number of remaining states. Now, for 1 plus SPM, so it's the same problem, but now this is our proximity measure. Right? So we have the alpha, which is the Lagrange multipliers, and then are multiplied by the state fidelity between our training quantum states and our test quantum states. And there are 2 ways of finding this proximity measure. Right? So I mean, on the one hand, you can just compute, you can measure the fidelity between your training states and your test state using the swap test. But then to calculate the Lagrange multipliers, you can use your classical matrix inversion. So that goes as n to the cubed. So in that kind of case, you don't get an advantage in the number of training states, but you do get an advantage in your dimensionality. But an alternative way is to make this whole form just a single type of inner product. And then you can use the HHL algorithm for matrix inversion. And then get an advantage also in the number of training states. Okay, so and then we also have the mixed form, where now the state fidelity between is replaced by the state fidelity between quantum states. And there again use the same kind of swap test, and you find the scaling that you expect. So it goes as polynomially in the number of training states, but logarithmically in the. So this is the basic summary, right? And then I'll sort of end with some of the open questions. So like I said, this is sort of taking like a first tentative step, in seeing if quantum machine learning helps for quantum anomaly detection. And we're looking at a very, very simplest type of algorithm, but so we see that sort of as the very beginning, because anomaly detection is really a very big field in its own right. But in quantum cases, there's not only machine learning, but there are also state discrimination methods, which John Gale and Ramon will be talking about. What we would like to know is, what is the relationship between these two kinds of methods? Right? Is there an advantage to be gained, in one type of regime compared to another? Well, we don't know, but it's something we'd like to find out. And also the comparison between different types of machine learning algorithms. Machine learning is sort of seen as kind of dirty in the way you're playing with data. You don't really know a priori, right? which methods are good for what. So it'd be good to actually test these algorithms using that same spirit on quantum states. Also, in intrusion type of scenarios, you would like to be able to say something if you're only given a single copy of your test data. So we're investigating that, and also with anomaly localization algorithms. So if you're in a computer network, you like to know where your anomaly actually occurs, not just which piece of your data are anomalies. So finally, thank you to my collaborator, Patrick Graffin Trust, and then thank you to everyone who I've discussed this with. I think most of you guys in this room now. So thank you.
Okay, in the interest of time, let's settle on a single question.
I know I've skimmed a lot, so just come and see me afterwards.
Okay, let's settle for that then. Let's thank the speaker again.